Praise the Lord, God's children, because this is a day that the Lord has made, and we will rejoice and be glad in it. Amen. Hallelujah. Welcome to the Master's Word. You know, we've reversed our programs today, and for the future, we will be doing only our program for the Master's Word will be now at 8 o'clock in the morning and on Mondays instead of 9:30, and instead we have at 9 o'clock we have our Ustream broadcast with Elder Anyat Mashi from Pakistan. So from now on, you'll be picking us up at 8 o'clock in the morning here for the Master's Word. Now remember that this is the Master's Word. So I'm your host, Dr. Stephanie, and all Master's Word programs are Christian internet radio and TV talk shows. They're directed at educating, edifying, and helping the body of Christ to gain understanding of God's Word and who they are in Christ Jesus. Okay, so let's pray and get started, shall we? Father, we come into your presence with praise and thanksgiving in our hearts. It's just overflowing through our lips. We praise you, we love you, and we adore you. We thank you, Lord, that as we seek you, you always illuminate your word so that we can gain proper understanding of it. We thank you for the Rhema word of God, for revelation, knowledge, and manifestation of your word in our hearts and minds. And thank you for the gift of utterance, and bless those that have ears to hear, Lord, as we endeavor to know you more intimately and love you more and more deeply. Holy Spirit, you're invited right now, please, to take over this broadcast. In Jesus' name, amen. Now, did you come expecting to receive today? If you don't expect to receive from God, then you won't. So get that expectation level up there. You know that you'll come away each time with more head and heart knowledge. So, my brothers and sisters, expect to receive. Right now, let's just give God some worship, shall we? We want to make sure that we bring in the Holy Spirit. So that's what we're going to do right now. love you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Holy Spirit, we just are happy to have you with us today. Now, you know, remember that God inhabits the praises of his people. So that's why we're praising. We want him here. Today I want to help you discover what it means to be in Christ. We started this series last week, and we're going to continue on it on that path now. You need to know who you are in Christ, and it's vitally important. So we're going to be on this for a while. Now, the phrase in Christ or in him is found many times, at least 88 times, in the New Testament. My favorite verse of all is Colossians 2, verse 10, which reads, "And you are complete in him, who is the head of all principality and power." The idea, you know, that idea of completeness should be comforting to us, because he speaks of lacking nothing, not in want or needing no thing to be added to us. Even though we may have times of physical need, we know from this verse that our times of spiritual need are behind us when we are in Christ. Now, another section of scripture that is equally as comforting is found in the first chapter of Ephesians. Listen to these comforting words. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places in Christ, just as he chose us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and without blame before him in love, having predestined us to adoption as sons by Jesus Christ to himself, according to the good pleasure of his will, to the praise of the glory of his grace, by which he has made us accepted in the Beloved. Ephesians 1:3-6. In him we have redemption, through his blood, the forgiveness of sins, according to the riches of his grace, which he made abound toward us in all wisdom and prudence, having made known to us the mystery of his will, according to his good pleasure, which he purposed in himself, that in the dispensation of the fullness of the times he might gather together in one all things in Christ, both which are in heaven and which are on earth, in him. Ephesians 1:7-10. In him also we have obtained an inheritance, being predestined according to the purpose of him who works all things, according to the counsel of his will, that we who first trusted in Christ should be to the praise of his glory. Ephesians 1:11-12. In him you also trusted after you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, in whom also, having believed, you were sealed with the Holy Spirit of promise, who is the guarantee of our inheritance, until the redemption of the purchased possession, to the praise of his glory. Ephesians 1:13-14. Okay, look at all that's true of you. All of that. It's all true of you. All of you who believe in this one section of God's Word. If you believed in Jesus Christ, if you believe in him, that he died for your sin, trusting in the promises of God, then all of this is true about you right now. You are blessed with every spiritual blessing in heavenly places in Christ. You are chosen before the foundation of the world. You are holy and without blame. You have been adopted. You are accepted and you are redeemed. You have forgiveness of sins. You know the mystery of his will. You have obtained an inheritance. You are his glory. You are sealed with the Holy Spirit. Your inheritance is guaranteed. Hallelujah! That all belongs to you if you're born again. So what does it do to you to read a list like that? Do you, like me, look at that list and say to yourself, I don't deserve that? Well, you're right, you don't. You don't deserve any of that. In fact, none of us does. From the greatest to the least among us, none of us deserves to be treated that way. We deserve to be punished for our sin. I've sinned against the Lord in thought, word, and deed. Try as I might, every day ends up with me having done something to the very things that I tried not to do. I don't know about you, but I'm not perfect. I'm working on it. And I've found that I haven't, even though I've done the things I try hard not to do, I'm not doing the things I tried so hard to do right. And even if I could become better at not sinning, I know that I would still mess up eventually. See, no matter how successful I was at mortifying the flesh, no matter how many things I didn't do or how many good things I did do, I would still be left with the problem of my sinful nature. It's still in there. That's the beautiful thing about the good news. There is someone who can rescue me from this dilemma, and that someone is Jesus the Christ, the Son of God, who became flesh and dwelt among us, who lived a perfect life for me, who died the perfect death in my place, and whom God raised for me so that I could be saved from the penalty of sin, be forgiven of all sin, past, present, and future, and be declared righteous before God. And all these things listed here are now true about me. They are a reality in God's eyes because he has promised in his word that they are true. See, God doesn't lie. He doesn't go back on his word. He doesn't back away from his promises. To be in Christ means that all of the things that the Bible says are true about a believer in Jesus, and they are a present reality and can be enjoyed in the here and now. For you did not receive the spirit of bondage again to fear, but you received the spirit of adoption by whom we cry out, Abba, Father. Romans 8:15. You don't have to live in fear of the fires of hell nipping at your heels, my friends, as so many preachers teach and suggest. But you can rest in the promises of God that your inheritance is guaranteed, that it is an objective reality, all right? That you already possess it, and that you are accepted by God because you believe in Jesus the Christ. How should we then live? In confidence that we are adopted by our Heavenly Father as securely as those who are chosen, that were chosen before the foundation of the world, and as holy and without blame as those who are complete in Christ, who is the head and principality and power, of all principality and power. He's the head of all that. Now, we live this life out of our position in Christ, my friends. I want you to understand this. We live this life here on this earth out of our position in Christ, not as some say by trying all the harder to prove it. Okay? And so, what of sin then? When sin accuses, we say, yes, I am a sinner. What of it? My Lord and Jesus is a greater Savior. I have been saved by His mercy through the washing of regeneration and renewing of the Holy Spirit. And the scripture reference for that is Titus 3:5. For it is written, greater is He that is in you than he that is in the world. 1 John 4:4. And that's what it means to be in Christ. Now that we know what it means to be in Christ, let's take an in-depth look at the marvelously wondrous blessings of being in Christ. You know, the church today is steeped in a time of tremendous light. There's a plethora of teaching available to us, and the Holy Spirit has revealed to us the infinite blessings of Jesus' finished work on the cross. Hallelujah. However, you know, there was a time when Christ's wonderful work was hidden away and obscured from clear view to the world. That period was called the Dark Ages, when the actual meaning of the cross and the clarity that we should view it in was veiled from sight to the majority of humanity. Now, most preachers during that time preached sermons focused primarily on God's wrath, condemnation and damnation, hellfire and brimstone. Popes and priests all the same preached a gospel of works, and the people were taught to perform a variety of acts to try and find peace with their God. They traveled great distances to visit shrines. They knelt in worship before stone icons, repeated long prayers, and at times whipped themselves in punishment for sins they thought they had committed. So just what was all of this accredited to? It was due to lack of knowledge. Lack of knowledge and understanding of who they actually are in Christ. You see, all of these things, all of these acts on the people's part only increased their bondage and kept them blinded to the truth of the gospel that would set them free. Now, I've found that even today, with all the teaching available to us, most Christians still don't understand the importance of Christ's work for us on the cross. So I'm going to shed some light on the most important aspect of what Jesus did for us on that cross. I'm going to give you illumination on what it means to be in Christ. Being in Christ is the only firm foundation on which we can build a holy life. Without this foundation, we will continually and repeatedly return to our flesh, or what we know in the natural realm as self-reliance. Why? Because we are actually trying to produce holiness in ourselves. However, true holiness is obtained only through knowing the riches of God in Christ Jesus. Well, what is holiness? Holiness is being separated out from the pack, set apart, keeping the statutes and the ordinances set down by God and fulfilled by Christ. Titus 2:11-12 tells us, the grace of God that brings salvation has appeared to all men, teaching us that denying ungodliness and worldly lust, we should live soberly, righteously, and godly in this present world. Only God's grace is going to teach us how to be holy, my friends. Works and labors on our part in the natural will never produce that. It's only as we take a hold of the blessing, our empowerment to perform and accomplish the will and purpose of God, that we are placed here on this earth to do, and to grasp the blessings that are ours, given to us by God through Jesus the Christ, and understand them, what they mean, and how we operate in them, that knowledge comes. That knowledge only comes by being in Christ. Now, once we gain that revelation, we're able to build then on a firm foundation. So, what I want you to do is listen to what Colossians has to say about it. All right, Colossians chapter 1, verse 27. Turn there. It says, To whom God would make known what is the riches of the glory of this mystery among the Gentiles, which is Christ in you, the hope of glory. Now think about this. We as born-again believers have the hope of glory, our salvation and our supernatural abilities that are reestablished in us at our new birth. But look at the church today. I mean, no power, lack of interest in the things of God, praising and worshiping on Sunday, then living a worldly life the rest of the week. The power of God is not effective in our lives. So where is the hope of glory? What value has it for us today? I mean, we try to understand the scriptures and we read the promises of God to us believers, and yet we have no manifestation of that power of God that we read about and long for. Jesus wants us to have it. He's there at the ready to hand it to us. Just what does the believer have to offer the non-believer then? I mean, think about this. What do we as believers have to offer the non-believer that's so inviting that he wants to make that exchange from death to life? Except an eternal life, which we really already have in some form or other, according to the Word of God, that is. You see, the Bible tells us that if we don't receive Christ, we live eternally tortured in hell. Now, if this sounds all too familiar, well, it's true. And the reason that we're in this dilemma is because we don't know who we are in Christ, what power we have, why we have it, and how to operate in it. You know, God spoke to Isaiah about a certain servant who delighted his heart. He said, "Behold my servant, whom I uphold, mine elect, in whom my soul delighteth." That's Isaiah 42, verse 1. Well, just who is this one whom God sustains, that Isaiah is speaking about? Who is that? Matthew answers that question. Jesus, when he was baptized, went up straightway out of the water, and lo, the heavens were opened unto him, and he saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove and lighting upon him. And lo, a voice from heaven saying, "This is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased." Matthew 3:16 and 17. The Hebrew word for "I am well pleased" here is delight. In other words, God was saying, "My soul delights in my Son, Jesus Christ." Now, we know that throughout the Old Testament, vast amounts of livestock were offered up to the Lord as sacrifices. However, not one of these sacrifices brought the Lord any pleasure. How do we know that? Because Hebrews chapter 10, verses 4 through 6 tells us, "It is not possible that the blood of bulls and of goats should take away sins. In burnt offerings and sacrifices for sin thou hast had no pleasure." Yet in the next verse, verse 7, we read these wonderful words from Jesus. "Then said I, Lo, I come to do thy will, O God." So you see, Christ came to earth to do what no animal sacrifice could do. "Wherefore, when he cometh into the world, he saith, Sacrifice and offering thou wouldest not, but a body hast thou prepared me." Hebrews 10:5. What does that mean? It says God has prepared a physical body for Jesus here on the earth. That would provide the perfect sin sacrifice for all people forever. Now, 1 Peter 3:18 tells us, For Christ also hath once suffered for sins, the just for the unjust, that he might bring us to God." Okay, from the very foundation of the world, God had only one plan. That plan was to reconcile fallen, sinful mankind, my friends. God's plan for salvation was simple. He said this, think about this, "I'm going to send forth my own Son as a Redeemer, and after he has died, after he has risen and stands before me in glory, I will then recognize only him, only Christ, who is the very essence of God, could ever stand personally before the Father. God the Father would only recognize Christ, the servant who perfectly pleased and delighted him. Almighty God said, "My Son is the only worthy sacrificial lamb. He will gather up into himself all of those who have been separated from me by sin, and he will reconcile them back to me." Now, when Jesus said, "A body hast thou prepared me," in Hebrews 10:5, he meant not just a human body, but a spiritual body as well. That spiritual body consists of all who believe in him. Ephesians 4, verse 4 tells us, "There is one body, and all who are in Christ, by faith or born again, are born into this spiritual body. We are members of his body, of his flesh, and of his bones." Ephesians 5:30. That's right. The exciting thing about this is that there is a physical man in heaven. Jesus, the Son, is seated at the right hand of the Father. However, he's not seen physically with the naked eye in this world. The fact is, we believers who make up Christ's body are the only Jesus that this world will ever see. That's right. Now in Micah chapter 6, Israel, backslidden at the time, asked, "How can we stand before a holy God? Wherewith shall I come before the Lord and bow myself before the high God? Shall I come before him with burnt offerings, with calves of a year old? Will the Lord be pleased with thousands of rams or 10,000s of rivers of oil? Shall I give my firstborn for my transgression, the fruit of my body for the sin of my soul?" Micah 6, 6-7. See, the Israelites were asking a really good question here. How can any human being approach a holy God? How can we ever please him and be accepted by him? What kind of a sacrifice does he want from us? Our blood? Our bodies? Does he want our children? We know that our good works, our being kind in nature and exhibiting generosity, are as filthy rags in God's sight. So how are we going to be accepted by God? Well, Paul wrote in Ephesians 1, verse 6, "He hath made us accepted in the Beloved." So we are accepted only as we are in the Beloved, that is, in Christ, as we are a portion of his body. That in the dispensation of the fullness of times he might gather together in one all things in Christ, both which are in heaven and which are on the earth, even in him. Through him we both have access by one Spirit unto the Father. Ephesians 2:18. So in other words, we don't have any access to God other than by being in Christ. How do we get there? Get saved. So if you've given your heart completely to Jesus, you may have asked the same questions that Israel asked. Lord, how can I possibly please you? I am unable to stand before you with all my failures and faults. Every time I think I'm making progress, I take 2 steps forward and 3 steps back. Should I read more of the Bible? Spend more time in prayer? Lord, what is it that you want from me? Well, all of those things are a plus. Yes, he does want that from you, but that's not it. God's answer to us is just as he answered Israel. I don't want any of your sacrifices or good works. I recognize only the work of my Son, who delights and pleases me. Yet I have selected you as my Son's beloved bride. You see, I chose you from before the foundation of the world to be married to him. I wooed you and courted you. I convicted you and through my Spirit I brought you into him. How could I not delight in my Son's bride, the bride of my own choosing? I can't hate my own flesh. Jesus prayed to the Father, "All mine are thine, and thine are mine, and I am glorified in them." John 17:10. The love wherewith thou hast loved me may be in them, and I in them. John 17:26. Jesus makes it perfectly clear that when we are in him, we are one with him. He and me in him, one singular being. When we are in that condition, in Christ, one in him, we enjoy the same love of the Father that he enjoys. See, God delights in us as much as he does in his own Son. He says, "I love all who are in my Son, for all who are his are mine." That was and still is his plan. We are joint heirs with Christ because we are in Christ. Now, when we receive Christ as Lord and Savior of our lives, we make this great exchange. It's much like a caterpillar turning into a butterfly. The caterpillar moves inside the chrysalis, and exchange takes place. The emergence that comes forth is a butterfly, a new creation. The old has passed away, and the new is revealed and in place. Now, that butterfly will never again be a caterpillar. He can't go back to being a caterpillar because he can't undo what's been done. Neither can we. I say neither can we. We accept Jesus, give him our hearts and lives, and we move into him. We emerge as a new creation. Only the difference is this. The butterfly doesn't have the caterpillar nature hanging around in the background, taunting him to come back to being a caterpillar. But we do have a sin nature that's completely removed, but the devil offers us its attributes daily in some way or another. We have a choice each day to remain activated in Christ, or to play with the dead thing. The dead sin nature, or old man, as it's often referred to. However, think about yourself being in Christ. You move into him, and at the same time, he moves into you, and you become one being, one entity. You are completely ensconced in him, totally surrounded by him, inside of him, and protected by him. You, being in him, must realize that you put him on like a suit of clothes. Your hands inside of his hands, your arms inside of his arms, like putting on a suit, putting on a coat. Your head goes inside his head, giving you the mind of Christ. Your legs inside his legs. He goes wherever you go, and you go wherever he goes. Being one together, you share his divine health, wholeness, nature. He takes your sickness, disease, and diminished mindset, and he gives you his life and vibrancy of his divine health and wholeness, his supernatural powers that now connect you with your own God DNA. It connects you back to the blessing. You are in him, he is in you, the hope of glory is yours, my friends. Your body and spirit are now renewed to the breath of life that God breathed into you at creation. Every word you speak now is spoken on God's breath. So speak life. Are you with me? The Bible also tells us that God is our Father, just as he is Christ's Father. All right, Jesus said in John 20, verse 17, I ascend unto my Father and your Father, and to my God and your God. Are you striving, working, sweating, trying hard to please God? Do you go through periods where you feel you're delighting him, making him happy, and then others when you think you can't do anything right? All if you're doing is displeasing him? Well, my dear friends, if that's the case, then we have to put facts ahead of our feelings. The fact is, God's pleasure in us has nothing to do with our strivings, our intensity, our emotional reactions, or our good intentions. The bottom line is that it all has to do with our faith. The book of Hebrews talks about this very issue. It says that when we move away from the foundational doctrine of being accepted by God by being in Christ, we depart from the Lord and turn back to the bondage of the law and flesh. However, we which have believed do enter into rest. For he that is entered into his rest has also ceased from his own works, as God did from his. Hebrews 4, 3 and 10. Scripture makes it abundantly clear. The evidence of faith is rest. Now here's the bottom line. The only way to bring your striving, sweating, troubled soul into peace is to be convinced that you are in Christ, and in him you are accepted by God and pleasing to him. Period. End of report. See, God delights in me, regardless of whether I'm up or down. No matter how I feel, I know my position in Christ, that I'm seated with him in heavenly places. I'm seated with him in heavenly places. Okay, so what evidence do we have that we are truly in Christ? I mean, we want to see that we are truly, you know, have what we say we have here, and that the Bible isn't telling us some sort of a misnomer. Okay, let me give you three of the clearest evidences from Scripture. And please note that these are contingent on this. Number one, having repented of sin, forsaken wickedness, trusted in Christ for eternal salvation, and allowed him to translate you out of the darkness and into this kingdom of light. In other words, that you have become a born-again believer. Here's our three evidences. One, you are in Christ if you are continually in the process of being renewed. You see, those who are in Christ don't rest on a one-time conversion experience. Instead, they constantly cry out to be changed and renewed by the Holy Spirit. Their daily prayer goes something like this. Lord, remove from me everything that's not like you. Remake me into the image of your dear Son. Remember this, if any man be in Christ, he's a new creature. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things become new. 2 Corinthians 5:17. Not by works of righteousness which we have done, but according to his mercy he saved us, by the washing of regeneration and renewing of the Holy Ghost, which he shed on us abundantly through Jesus Christ our Savior. Titus 3:5 and 6. The word regeneration here means making anew or reviving and producing something new. So Paul is saying the Holy Spirit is at work in you, giving you a complete makeover, folks. Christ has the Holy Spirit without measure, and because we are part of his body, his Spirit flows down to each one of us. Even as we are in Christ, we are being nourished by his Spirit, made over into the image of Jesus himself. Praise his name. Number two, you are in Christ if you govern your life by the Scriptures. Do you revere and fear God's word? Do you go daily to the mirror of the Bible to be changed by it? Whoso keepeth his word, in him verily is the love of God perfected. Hereby know we that we are in him. 1 John 2, chapter 2, verse 5. So Scripture is making it clear then that we know we're in Christ if we love and obey his word. And according to John, this is also how we know God's love is perfected in us. Paul wrote, pray for us that the word of the Lord may have free course and be glorified even as it is with you. 2 Thessalonians 3:1. The expression free course means meeting no opposition in you. Paul's saying, as you read or hear God's word, let it govern you. Honor it and make it true, make it the rule of your life. Now, Christians know this verse and quote it often. You shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. John 8:32. But that promise hinges on the verse preceding it. If you continue in my word, then are you my disciples indeed. John 8:31. The phrase, if you continue in my word, means if you live in and keep my commandments. And the commandments referenced here are not the Ten Commandments. In other words, as you are in me, I will reveal my truth to you, but I won't reveal it to you if you don't intend to live by it. You'll only know the truth only after you've committed to obey it. Number three, you are in Christ if your faith is mixed with charity, which is love. Scripture says if you don't have love or unconditional love, you can't be in Christ. Though I have the gift of prophecy and understanding all mysteries and all knowledge, and though I have all faith so that I could remove mountains and have not love, I am nothing. 1 Corinthians 13:2. You can be an extremely gifted preacher. You can be a powerful evangelist. You can heal others by faith. You can move mountains by speaking one single word. You can teach God's word with power and anointing. But if you don't have love for others, it all counts for nothing. However, if we love one another, God dwells in us, and his love is perfected in us. Hereby know we that we dwell in him, and he in us, because he has given us of his Spirit. 1 John 4, 12-13. So Paul lists a number of fruits of love, but I want to focus on just one. If you possess the following fruit, then you have the clearest evidence that Christ resides in you and you in him. And this is it. Charity, or love. That's what it means. Charity equals love. Love is not easily provoked. 1 Corinthians 13, 4-5. The Greek word for provoked is parazuno, and it comes from a root word meaning acid and quick or sudden. It has an additional meaning, root meaning of one chosen by. One close by. I'll get my head on straight this morning. The additional root meaning of one close by. So put all this together, that means these meanings become evident. To be provoked is to fly off the handle with acid remarks, to have a temper tantrum, and to aim it all at someone close to you. The Bible is telling us, if you are in Christ, then you are loving unconditionally, and you'll no longer be easily provoked. Our greatest test of this fruit comes from those closest to us, our spouse, children, our friends, our brothers and sisters in Christ even. So, do you have a short fuse? How easily does your temper flare? If you are in Christ, a wee small voice will rise up in you whenever you grow angry, and it will cry out, Lord, help me. Holy Spirit, calm me down. Now, I can tell you this. I had this experience just the other day. I was talking to my sister, and I was trying to help her do something, and try as I would to explain it, I was having a terrible time getting my thoughts across. And she was talking down my throat, kind of, and we got into it. And it wasn't really a full-fledged knockdown, drag-out argument. It was needling. And we were needling one another. The Holy Spirit kept saying to me, stop it, stop it, stop it. Calm down, stop it, stop it, stop it. But I didn't say, Lord, help me. Lord, Holy Spirit, you calm me down. He was telling me to calm down. I didn't do it. And we got into it until some real cross words were said, which, you know, you can't take back. Of course, later, after I got over being angry, I went in and repented and apologized, but that's too late. The die was cast. But I ended up going off by myself right afterwards, after I'd spewed out this ugliness. And I don't care whether it was equal or not. She was just as equally ugly with me. But it doesn't matter about what she did. What matters is, what did I do? What did I do? How did I respond? So I went in and sat down in the other room by myself quietly. And my head was ready to explode, aching. I could feel and hear my blood pounding in my head. And I was just out of breath. You know, and I sat there and thought, why did I do that? Why did I let the enemy needle me? Because it was the enemy, that demonic atmosphere. It wasn't my sister. It was a demonic atmosphere. And she was allowing the enemy to needle her through me. Until we both got mad. You know, some people say, well, I got mad and then I felt better afterwards. Not me. I felt awful. I felt just yucky afterwards. So what I'm saying is, if I had cried out, you know, I listened to the Holy Spirit crying out to me, I should have said, Lord, help me. Holy Spirit, calm me down. And thought of other things. It bit my tongue so that I wouldn't speak. I didn't have to. I didn't have to do that, but I chose to do it. See, the enemy offered it to me on a platter, and I stepped over there and snatched it bald-headed. I took it. Now, you may not be perfect, but if you are in Christ, then you're continually dealing with these issues in your life through the power of the Holy Spirit. And by faith, you can be totally accepted by the Father, no matter what your struggle, because of the fact that you are in Christ, and He's in you. So it's time for you to rejoice over your blessed position in Christ, folks. You're the Heavenly Father's beloved child, His delightful servant who is forever being changed into His Son's image, all because Christ is in you and you are in Him. Thank Him for this marvelous gift, because it is, and allow yourself to be transformed by His Word and His Spirit. Walking daily in His unmerited favor and grace, and being totally protected from the enemy's onslaughts. Removed from sickness and disease and lack, wrapped in the warmth of the love of God and in Christ, covered completely by the armor of God, living in Christ. You know what? When you're living in Christ, you are in the secret place of the Most High, because Christ is that secret place. So being in Christ Jesus is a magnificent reality. It's breathtaking that we discover being in Christ, what it means to be in Christ. To be in Christ means this. It means united to and in Christ, bound to Christ. If you are in Christ, listen to what it holds for you. In Christ Jesus, you are given grace before the world was even created. He gave us grace in Christ Jesus before the ages began. 2 Timothy 1:9. In Christ Jesus, you were chosen by God before creation. Ephesians 1:4 says, God chose us in Christ before the foundation of the world. Number 3, in Christ Jesus, you are loved by God with an inseparable love. Romans 3:38-39 tell us, I am sure that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. Now, in Christ Jesus, you were redeemed and given forgiven for all of your sins, past, present, and future. Ephesians 1:7 says, in Christ we have redemption through His blood, the forgiveness of our trespasses. Number 5, in Christ Jesus, you are justified before God and righteous, and the righteousness of God in Christ is imputed to you. 2 Corinthians 5:21 tells us that for our sake God made Christ to be sin who knew no sin, so that in Him we might become the righteousness of God. Number 6, in Christ Jesus you are a new creation and a son of God. 2 Corinthians 5:17. If anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old's passed away. Behold, the new has come. Galatians 3:26 says, in Christ Jesus you are all sons of God through faith. 7, in Christ Jesus you have been seated in the heavenly places, even while He lived on this earth. Ephesians 2:6, God raised us up with Christ and seated us with Him in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus. Number 8, in Christ Jesus, all the promises of God are yes and amen for you. 2 Corinthians 1:20, all the promises of God find their yes in Christ. Number 9, in Christ Jesus, you are being sanctified and made holy. 1 Corinthians 1:2 says, to the church of God that is in Corinth, for those sanctified in Christ Jesus. So number 10, Jesus Christ is everything you really need and will be supplied. All right? Philippians 4:19 says, my God will supply every need of yours according to His riches and glory in Christ Jesus. Number 11, in Christ Jesus, the peace of God will guard your heart and mind. Philippians 4:7. The peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Number 12, in Christ Jesus, you have eternal life. Romans 6:23. For the wages of sin is death, but the free gift of God is eternal life in Jesus Christ our Lord. Number 13, and in Christ Jesus, you will be raised from the dead at the coming of the Lord. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 22 says, for as in Adam all die, so as in Christ Jesus all shall be made alive. All those united to Adam in the first humanity die. All those united to Christ in the new humanity rise to live again. Hallelujah. So how do we get into Christ? Well, the unconscious and decisive level is God's sovereign work. From God you are in Christ Jesus. 1 Corinthians 1:30. But at the conscious level of our own action, it's through faith. Christ dwells in our hearts through faith. Ephesians 3:17. The life we live in union with His death and life, we live by faith in the Son of God. Galatians 2:20. So we are united in His death and resurrection through faith. Colossians 2:12. This is a marvelous truth, my friends. Union with Christ is the ground of everlasting joy, and it is free. It's free, it's free, it's free. Did you receive this today? Well, I pray that you did. If you have questions or need further assistance with understanding these messages, please do contact me. Now, I want to invite you to join us on Sundays, every Sunday, for the Master's Touch Worship Service at 10 a.m. on Ustream.tv and at 6 p.m. on Spreaker.com. These services are complete with praise and worship, soaking worship, the Word of God, Holy Communion, and a visitation from the Holy Spirit for those who will receive. If you need more of the Lord, come join us. If you want to bask in the presence of the Lord and Savior, come join us. God is on the move, and you don't want to miss being a part. So join us and flow with God. That's 10 a.m. on Ustream.tv and 6 p.m. on Spreaker.com. Come expecting to receive. Now, also, I want to invite you to join us for the Master's Touch, Tuesdays at 8 a.m. on Ustream.tv. These programs are healing services which include praise and worship, soaking worship, the Word of God, administration of Holy Communion, and the laying on of hands. Now, I'll totally prepare you to receive your healing from God. I've been doing this for years, and under the guidance and direction now of the Holy Spirit, we're bringing healing to you through the cyber community, praise His name. So if you have need of healing of any kind, you can send us an email describing your situation, your symptoms, your diagnosis, condition, whatever. And you may send them to us at mthsprayer@cox.net. That's mthsprayer@cox.net or masterstouchhs@cox.net. That's masterstouchhs@cox.net. One more, poet@cox.net. Poet stands for a Peace on Earth team. So you just put the word poet@cox.net, and that's how you can get a hold of us on email. But you know what? The best thing to do is just come to a service. You know why? Because I'll take you by the hand and lead you through the entire thing. Oh, my gosh. My muscles are so sore. We've been moving things around the house. So again, those services, the healing services, are Tuesday mornings, Master's Touch, healing service Tuesday mornings at 8 a.m. Pacific time on Ustream.tv. Now, come, and come expecting to receive. Don't forget to tune in to the Master's Prayer Room, broadcast Tuesdays at 9:30 a.m. Pacific time on Spreaker.com. Just following the Master's the Master's Touch Healing Service. All prayer requests may be submitted by email prior to the program. I've given you the emails. I'll go over them again. But I'm going to pray for you over your requests. I'll do it with you. And we're seeing marvelous results from these streaming live prayer programs, my friends. That's Tuesdays at 9:30 a.m. All of this is on Pacific time on the Master's Prayer Room on Spreaker.com. Everyone is welcome to receive from the live prayer programs. Join us, won't you? All the Master's programs bring you more in-depth teaching of God's Word. And for a full programming schedule, go to our website, www.themasterstouch.org. That's themasterstouch.org. Once again, email us at masterstouch@cox.net, masterstouchhs@cox.net, masterstouchhs@cox.net, poet@cox.net, that's poet@cox.net, or mthsprayer@cox.net. Remember, Proverbs 4, verse 7 says, wisdom is the principal thing, therefore get wisdom, when with all you're getting, get understanding. That's the key thing. This is what we're talking about. This is why you come to listen to these programs. Wisdom is the principal thing, therefore get wisdom. How do you do that? Keep your mind in the Word. And with all you're getting, get understanding. You can't, if you don't understand it, you can't operate in it. And continually make an effort to keep Jesus Lord of your life. Amen? Okay. You know, the Master's Word is an extension of the Master's Touch Healing School of Ministry International. We're a 501c3 organization. And I want you to get this in your heart, my friends. As Jesus is, so are we in this world. God bless you.